in liberating strife, who more than self, their country loved, and mercy more than
Color Guard, under the command of Lieutenant Commander Ernest Correll. Ladies and gentlemen, our good friend, Mr. Sal Richards.
I'm really happy to be back here, especially this year. And by the way, I gained the weight that Tony Orlando lost. I mean, all these diets, everybody wants a diet. It's impossible to lose weight. I'm going absolutely out of my mind. I went on a SlimFast diet a couple of weeks ago, okay? I was 198 pounds. I'm up to 205. It's crazy with the diets. And I just got in from New York, although I live in West Palm Beach, Florida. I went to New York, and New York is great if you've been back to New York when you have to cross the streets, something similar to here. When the light flashes, you gotta walk, don't walk, walk, don't walk, walk, don't walk. And when you go to park your car, you gotta read the sign for an hour and a half, whether you can park or not. No parking, 9 to 5, 4 to 5, 3 to 5, 2 to 5, 6 to 5. Okay. No standing on Tuesday, no walking on Friday, no talking on Thursday. Then we have that stupid law, take your dog outside, let him crap in a bag, bring it back in the house. Excuse me? If your dog's got to go, you got to chase him with a Ziploc. Come on, Spotty, shit in the bag. What if the dog was from Brooklyn and he could talk? Woof, hey. Now let me get this straight. You want me to go outside, crap in a bag, and bring it back in the house? I got an idea. Why don't you tie the bag to my tail? I'll sit in the house, I'll crap all day, we'll watch soap operas. All right, you're a good crowd already, I can tell. You come here spirited and with all that, and the hell with the Brooklyn Dodgers. I'll never speak about them again tonight. No, I will. Because they're going to win the pennant and they're going to win the series. That's what I say. At this particular time, I'd like to bring out a gentleman that's going to come out and talk to you for a few minutes and present some of the other performers that we have here tonight. We've got a lot of wonderful performers here tonight. This guy is the founder of the Improv and a friend of all comedians, an and he's also a friend of the New York Alumni. Ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to present to you Mr. Bud Friedman, please.
Thank you. Isn't that great? Thank you. Thanks, guys. That's terrific. I'm on stage. That they haven't forgotten my theme song. Anyway, it is a great pleasure to be back here. I am a friend of the New York Alumni. As a matter of fact, I emceed the very first show for the New York Alumni when we honored our very dear friend, Mr. Phil Foster. And it was a quiet night, and it was in some warehouse downtown, before downtown was chic. And we're all out here now in Beverly Hills High School, where, by the way, I don't know if you noticed, if you're in the building, the yearbook is going for $110. Did it make you feel old and poor? The man I'm about to introduce played a role here in Los Angeles when Les Mis was playing here. One of our favorite shows. My wife and I have seen Les Mis here, Los Angeles, New York, Paris even. It's a treat to hear him sing live tonight. Because he is so special. He is also the cantor at the Temple of the Performing Arts. I just asked him which is his day job. He can't quite make up his mind. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and nice, warm New York Alumni Award for Mr. Jordon Bennett. Ladies and gentlemen, Jordon.
Thank you very much. So nice to see you all this evening. This first song I'm going to do for you was originally done by a very wild and wacky British comedy troupe called Monte Python in one of their films. And then not too long ago it was used in a Jack Nicholson film, As Good As It Gets. And now it's having added success in a show that's playing all around the world called Spamalot, which is kind of a Monte Python musical. Now remember when you went to see Peter Pan? And there comes a point of the show where Peter is inadvertently about to drink a cup of poison. And Tinkerbell sees this. And so to save Peter, she flies over and she drinks the poison. Now when Peter realizes what's happened, he panics and he breaks the fourth wall. He comes directly to the audience and he says, you, all of you, you people, you can help save Tinkerbell's life. All you have to do to save Tinkerbell's life is to applaud and clap as loud as you can, and you will save Tinkerbell's life! Well, imagine for the sake of this next song that I'm Tinkerbell. No, no! No, I'm not going to ask you to applaud, but what I am going to ask you to do is whistle, because there are points in this song where there's this lovely little whistling motif. And even if you don't know the song, it's very catchy, so you'll pick it up. If you still have problems, we have our crack whistling team back there, so they will help you out. You will figure this out. Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, don't rumble, give a whistle. And this will help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life is jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's a thing. And always look on the bright side. Try it this time. Always look on the right side of life. If life is quite absurd and death's the final word, you must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your sin, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life. Life is full of shit when you look at it. Life's a lark and just a joke, it's true. You'll see it it's all a show. Keep them laughing as you go. But remember that the last laugh is on you. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life. You're in a magnificent city, in a magnificent country, and you have plenty to eat and a roof over your head. What have you got to be unhappy about? Sing it with me! Always look on the bright side of life. Let me hear ya! Always look on the bright side of life. One more time! Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the bright side of life. Here we go, boys! Thank you very much. This next song was originally done by a British rock group called the Moody Blues in a concept album of theirs called Days of Future Past. Now, oh, before I go any further, how many people remember what an album is? Anyway, the whole idea of this album was, it was a day in the life of this man from morning to night. Now, this song is the night song. And it's about a guy going through a difficult breakup. Now, there's a couple of interesting images I wanted to just explain. The cold-hearted orb represents the moon, and the white satin is a layer of snow on the ground as the story is taking place. Here is the Moody Blues, Nights in White Satin. Cold-hearted orb that rules the night removes the colors from our sight. Red is gray and yellow white, but we decide which is right and which is an illusion. Night in white satin, never reaching the end. Letters I've written, never meaning to send. Beauty I always miss with these eyes before. Just what the truth is, I can't say anymore, 'cause I love you. Yes, I love you. They cannot defend just what you want to be. You will be in the end, 'cause I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh. nights in white satin, never reaching the end. Letters I've written, never meaning to send. Beauty I'd always been with these eyes before. Just what the truth is, I can't say anymore. I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, I love you. Oh, how I love you. Cause I love you. Yes, I love you.
Good friend, Mr. Stewie Stone. Stewie!
I can't tell you what a thrill this is. 35 years ago, I was in high school, and I'm back in high school. This is really terrific, what you people have done. $4 for a hot dog. Screw you. I mean, it's... In New York, on 47th Street, a buck and a half. How you screw the people out here, it's unbelievable. But I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York, so I understand. Be proud. I am from Livonia Avenue. That's it, where I still have a summer home. And the real name is Stewie Stone. I'm of the Hebraic faith, or as we know it in Brooklyn now, thanks to Al Sharpton, Jew bastard. And I know I look Italian. People say, how does a Jewish kid get a name like Stewie Stone? I will tell you the truth. My father came over on the boat. Not Royal Caribbean, a different kind of boat. His name was Reuben Sonnenberg. So somebody told him, change your name, so nobody know you're Jewish, you will blend it in America. So from Reuben Sonnenberg, it became Robert Stone. And it worked. Nobody ever knew he was Jewish. The fact he had a beard, yarmulke and tzitzis, had nothing to do with it. My father was a failed businessman in Brooklyn. He opened a cleaning store in a Hasidic neighborhood, and I love flying out here. I'm not here for the money, believe me. I had Lehman Brothers at 100. So to me, it's over for all of us. But anyway, I have to tell you, I just did a cruise. You were the youngest people I've seen in the last 2 weeks. If I hear the sound of phlegm one more time in my life, that's why you got a cruise. No goes on cruises. The parents of people who live in Florida. It's so good to see mature people that know how to dress. You go to Florida, these old guys wear clothes from 1912. It is the most amazing thing. And you know what's great about Florida? The greatest nightclub comic that ever lived taught me this, Milton Berle. The nicest man who took care of every young comedian. Milton Berle told me you could always spot an ethnic table in Florida by the way they order. If you listen, like an Italian table, this is what you hear. Hey, a little more vino over here. Irish table, a little more beer over here. Jewish table, we didn't get any rolls. Can we get some rolls? A man's worth $40 million. He's stealing prune Danish and sweet and low, only in Florida. Jews go to Florida to stock up on sweet and low for the rest of our life. We walk into restaurants and go, hide the sweet and low, the Jews are coming. You're laughing. I brought my uncle to a supermarket. He saw sweet and low on the show. He said, I never knew they came in boxes. But listen, as I mentioned, I live in Manhattan, and I can't believe what's going on in this country. We're going through the most difficult time I can remember, and I guess most of you people can remember. Are we in recession? Are we going into recession? You can't trust the politicians. You don't know what the hell is going on. We have a guy in New York, Elliot Spritzer. I hate that guy. He's the only Jew to pay retail. I hate that man. 4,000 for a hooker. This is a schmuck. Anyway. And then they catch John Edwards with a girl. It's always Democrats that are looking to schlup broads. Never Republicans. Republicans only want to screw the country. They don't care about them. Now, the big problem is because everybody's worried about inflation, what our dollar is worth. I don't know. I live in Manhattan. You live out here. You live in Beverly Hills? Ungestop, Beverly Hills. You have bucks. Is food expensive out here? I want to teach you something. In New York, ready for this? $4.98 for a head of lettuce in Manhattan. Really? I told the man, take the lettuce and stick it. He said, I can't. I have a $2 cucumber there already. Just... That is my favorite joke. You know why? I wouldn't lie to you. I've been doing that joke 20 years. I just changed the price of the lettuce and the cucumber every year. What a great joke. Now I'm going to tell you a little something about my life, because I try and be honest on stage. I can't fool an audience. You've seen hundreds of comedians. A joke is a joke is a joke. What's different about a comic is his life, the way he perceives things, and as much of the truth about himself as he's willing to expose to an audience. And all I can give you is truth. I told you I grew up in Brooklyn. I went to Rasmus Hall High School. I'm a Brooklyn College graduate. I'm proud of that fact. Now people say to me, are you married or you're divorced? How do I tell you this? I have been everything. I have lived it as the world turns. I am a screwed up human being. First, I lived with a woman for 10 years, okay? Fought like cats and dogs, so we decided to make it better. Now, how do you make it better if you cannot live with a woman?
Marry her.
I married her. Okay. I did. Disaster, so I got divorced. Which was a mistake. Some men can live alone. I am not capable of living without a woman in my life. I had nothing growing up. I had the most wonderful mother. She did everything in the world for me. I was a prince in my house. There's not a woman on earth that's going to make me do what my mommy didn't make me do. So consequently, when it comes to doing things around the house, I'm a cripple. I'll be honest. I cannot make a bed by myself. I cannot make toilet water blue. I mean, there's certain things. So I got married again. But this is different than most people. I did it all with the same woman. After 6 years of being divorced, I remarried my ex-wife. Which is a little strange. People say to me, what's it like to remarry your ex-wife? You know what it's like? It's like breaking out of jail and then breaking back in. I get this. Why would you marry your ex-wife? At the time, I had a good reason. I wanted to be near my money. We were able to work everything out. But I married a beautiful girl from Cherry Hill, New Jersey, which is a suburb of Philadelphia. She went to Temple University. I'm very proud of her. She majored in selfish. A wonderful girl. Now, I always get this from people. You must have remarried your ex-wife. Passion drove you to it. I love that when they feel sex is the motivating force in life. I'm glad I'm old enough to realize that the first thing that goes in a relationship is sex. Loving somebody, liking somebody, respecting somebody, live forever. Sex will die. You're married a lot of years, right, sir? Is sex still number one on your list? Yes? You're full of shit, okay? You come in here and lie. You're lucky if you remember your name. What the hell are you talking about? Listen, I'm 69 years old. Sex is not number one on my list. Regularity is number one on my list. I don't care about going, coming, going, I care about. I have learned I can live without sex. I cannot love without going caca the rest of my life. You want to see unhappy people? And I could say that here, because there's a lot of the tribe here. Jews are basically unhappy people. We are screwed up. You can tell by our music. Italians, gentle, happy people. Polish people, more your joy, happy people. Polish, 120, they will poke it to the grave. They're happy people. Jews. What kind of life is this? How come my son was such a putz? What is this? Moses screwed us up. When Moses came off Mount Sinai, he gave the world the Ten Commandments, a beautiful way to live our life, whether you're a Christian or a Jew. He also said the Jews were chosen. Remember those words, chosen? Got us in a lot of trouble for 5,000 years. You know what chosen means according to the Talmud? Chosen to work harder in the name of the Lord. Chosen to suffer in his name. We got two choices. Number one, to be buried quick. We die in the ground. Italians die, they have a party, they sing, they dance. If there's pasta left over, keep the body another 2 weeks. They don't care, there's no time there. Jews, right away. That's why Jewish grandparents never visit the grandchildren. You visit the grandchildren, take a nap on the couch, they will bury you. Okay, number two, we got a choice, white bread or matzah. We pick matzah. You know why? More pieces in the box. It had nothing to do with Moses talking to a burning bush, unleavened bread. Don't believe that Charlton Heston crap. More pieces in the box. You eat matzah, right, sir? Drink water, we'll form cement in your stomach. Jews have been constipated for 5,000 years. When Moses went to the Pharaoh and said, "Let my people go," he meant to the toilet. And people will say to me, "Is it true that you got married, divorced, and married again?" It's the gospel truth. And say, "Why would you do that?" Well, the first time around, I had a major problem, which I will share with you. I had a drinking problem. And I am proud to say it's been 18 years since I had a drink, which has saved my marriage and my life. I'm not a preacher, believe me. It was not easy. I could have never done it without heroin. So it a much bigger joke on the West Coast. But anyway, the main problem was my wife and I were unable to have a baby. Now, we wanted a baby more than life itself. We tried everything to have a baby, because believe me, I had a lot of dreams in life, a success, my name on a marquee. It's all unimportant. The most important thing in life is footprints that you are on this earth. And what are footprints? Children. And we tried everything to have a child. They tell you, make love with your socks on, make love with your socks off. One shoe on, one shoe off. Somebody said, "Try oysters." I was desperate, I tried oysters. They kept slipping off. And then then they had me wearing boxer shorts for everyone. Know about that? You have to wear boxer shorts because you have to be free to breathe and hang in the temperature. At my age, it is no joy wearing boxer shorts. When I walk in boxer shorts, I feel like a grandfather clock. You know, I walk, it goes tick, tock, tick. I stop short, it becomes 6:30. I don't need that, sir. Now, I've been doing this routine a long, long time. I have never had an ending for this routine, because you know, whenever a comic does anything, with laughter, there's a little pain behind it. We laugh through our pain. This next statement I make is the happiest thing I have ever said in life, because my wife and I are about the proud parents of a beautiful 11-year-old daughter. It's my first child ever, and I just celebrated my 69th birthday. Is this amazing? It's the joy of my life. She's a beautiful girl. Her name is Savannah. Is that a great name? Savannah. Named after her grandfather, Shmoyle. I don't know how that happened. People said to me, "What's it like having a baby at my age?" "Oh, it's like having grandchildren that never leave." But my daughter and I share so much, it's so great. You know, she used to wear a diaper, I wear a diaper. It's now, I must say this, it is a delight for me to come out here and pay tribute to these two great performers, but this gentleman, Jerry Stiller, when I was young, and we used to go to the improv, Bud Friedman was, in those days, with a monocle, a putz with a monocle, a Jew with a monocle. He thought it was Winston Churchill. I don't know what the hell was going on. But I would go with Rodney Dangerfield and Robert Klein, and we'd go watch Stiller and Mira perform and practice for what they were going to do on the Sullivan Show. And Jerry was always the one to give the young guys encouragement and tell you you're going to make it. And it's a delight that he's always been there for us, and whenever he performed anywhere, this man's the first one there to applaud for all of us. You're lucky to be honoring a man like this. I thank you for inviting me. I hope I come back for the next 100 years. Good night. God love you. Happy New Year.
Fortunately, I was educated at the Yale School of Drama and really doesn't need this microphone. Am I taking this off? Leaving it here, okay. This concludes the end of my segment as an MC, ladies and gentlemen. little too little and a little too late. And I'm going to turn you back to a professional. He started the show for us and a fabulous comedian. And he too flew all the way out here. Please welcome back Mr. Sal Richards. Sal.
Thank you, buddy. Thank you very much. I flew here. Bud told you I flew here. I hate to fly. Not because I'm afraid to fly. I hate to fly because I don't want to go through security anymore. It takes you longer to go through security now than it does for the flight. You know, you get to security until you take off your belt, take off your jacket, take off your shoes. I was standing in line. This guy in front of me took off his shoes. I never smelled anything so bad in my entire life. The whole line fell over. I got a way to beat him. We go naked. Really, go naked? Who's going to care? It's a new world. You walk through, if something beeps, beep, you tell the guy, hey, you find something in my ass, it's yours, keep it. I don't fly regular airlines anymore. I fly an airline from Italy, TAC Airlines. Know what that stands for? Take a chance. They're very congenial. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Take a Chance Airlines. Today, Take a Chance Airlines is going to live up to its name. Today, we're going in the air. No more driving on the highway. Today, we're going to go all the way up 90 feet. If we go a little bit too high, just this much, and there's no air in the cabin and you can't breathe, don't you worry about it. We're going to open a window for you. Now, before we take off, the pilot that wants to speak to you, he's from Rome, and his name is Pontius. That's his name, Pontius the Pilate. He's from Rome. You know who he is. Here comes the Pilate. Hello, this is your Pilate, Pontius the Pilate. Don't worry, my Jewish friends, this will not affect you at all. If the plane is gonna crash, no be scared. This'll get you up. Anybody ducking? All right, on with the show, ladies and gentlemen, because my job here is to keep you guys going and keep the show going. And I want to present to you that this time a man that I was happy to meet tonight. I met him before, but I was glad to see that he was here. He appeared on Broadway, had many, many hit records. He's an actor. He's a wonderful, wonderful singer. And you all know him. Ladies and gentlemen, please bring to the stage Mr. Ed Ames.
Favorites. It certainly is one of mine. It's the first song that I had that became a hit record. And people ask me to sing it wherever I go, so I'd like to sing it for you now. Fantastic. Try to remember the kind of September when life was slow. And oh, so mellow. Try to remember the kind of September when grass was green and grain was yellow. Try to remember the kind of September when you were a tender and callow fellow. Try to remember, and if you remember, then follow. Try to remember when life was so tender that no one went except the willow. Try to remember when life was so tender and dreams were kept beside your pillow. Try to remember when life was so tender and love was an ember about to billow. Try to remember, and if you remember, then
follow, 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 follow. The fire of September that made us mellow. Deep in December, our hearts should remember and
beautiful, isn't it? Well, in spite of the fact of my poor birthplace, I am here tonight for my friend Jack, who I admire greatly. I am very, very fond of him. He's a wonderful man, a loving man. You're going to hear a lot about him as the evening goes on, but I would like to say one thing. In later years, he had a great success in life for many, many years, but he had a certain amount of adversity at the end of his life in recent times. And so I would like to sing an inspirational song and dedicate it to Jack tonight. It's the song from the Man of La Mancha, Don Quixote's Quest. Dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable foe, to bear with unbearable sorrow, to run where the brave dare not go, to right the unrightable wrong, to love from afar, to try when your arms are too weary, to reach the unreachable star. This is my quest, to follow that star, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, be willing to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that my heart shall lie peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my that one man, scorned and covered with scars, still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable star.
Big voice, that was wonderful. and I'm sure he appreciated your applause like that. Please welcome a real friend of the New York alumni, Mr. Garry Marshal.
Hello, I came to play ball. Remember, we used to play slap ball. How many played? Some got hurt but came back to play. No playing slap ball. They blacktopped our field, so there is a canasta tournament in the back of the stage. But I'm here to talk. Jack is still here, Mr. Klugman. I'm here to talk about Jack. These are wonderful people. It was like an audition. I was casting backstage. Very funny people. Great comics. Let's hear it for all the great comics. And the wonderful Ed Ames, who is not from the... He's good. We love Ed Ames, but he's not from the neighborhood. He's from a different neighborhood. I am from the Bronx. And yay! We should say once before it goes, they could probably hear us in New York, Yankee Stadium, goodbye. One, two, three. Yankee Stadium, goodbye. Well, a lot of things change, but I don't. I'm glad to be here this season, so I'm starting now. Here I go, Jack. Good evening, people with accents. Glad to be here for Mr. Klugman. We are friends. We did a show together. Remember the name of the show, Jack? The Odd Couple. Quite a show. Now, people ask me, you know, how did that happen? How did you and Jack get together? And it was a kind of an interesting story that Jack would like to hear. So I'm going to tell it. No, it's true that Jack appears all over the country, still doing plays. He did two plays at my theater, the Falcon Theater in Burbank, and he did Death of a Salesman there, and he did Value of Names, and he's still brilliant on stage. But you wonder, how did I know that? How did I know that to cast him? Well, I didn't, because they said, we're going to do The Odd Couple. You'll develop it from Neil Simon, also from the Bronx. And you'll get Mickey Rooney and Dean Martin. Dean Martin, Mickey Rooney, that's it. Well, I wasn't exactly sure that was it, and I had gone to a show. It was called Gypsy. And in Gypsy was Jack Klugman, and he was in it. He was the manager. And Ethel Merman was the star. And she came out and she sang. Now, Ethel had a special rule. When she sang, the other actors had to look towards her, right at her. That was her rule. And Jack would look right at her. But when Ethel sang, she spritzed a little bit. And Jack would sit there, not flinching. Hey, Rose! He would yell at the whole thing. He sat there. Then later, he did like three steps, and that was it. And he half sang a song. He kind of talked it. That was it. And at the end of the show, when they came out for a bow, the audience cheered him. And I was thinking, what the hell did he do? He didn't do it. Ethel was running and shouting and jumping. The other girl was taking her clothes off. Jack, did. And then I realized, as I saw him, that the people loved him. They just loved his manner, his acting. He was so honest. And I said, that's the guy. And I called up and I said, I got the guy to play Oscar, Jack Klugman. And they said, no, he's a dramatic actor. He won an Emmy for The Defenders. That means he can't do comedy, right? Figures. I said, no, he's good. Look at the tape. He's funny too. He has a reel. And they sent the reel and they called and said, Garry, the heads of Paramount, Garry, we saw him. We don't think he's right. We don't like him. I said, why? Well, we don't like his mustache. I said, he has no mustache. What film were you looking at? What did you look at? And I checked, they looked at film on Jack Crucian. Who's a good guy, but he's not Jack Klugman. So finally, after all my standing up, they paid no attention to me. They went to get Mickey Rooney and Dean Martin, and they both turned it down, and we got Jack Klugman as Oscar. That was the end of the story. And so I am very excited to be here, Jack, for you, and it's going to be a big deal now for you coming up. But first, we're going to start with film clips about your career. Here we go.
Ring a bell with you.
Springfield, Iowa, ring the bell.
Where were you 8.5 months ago?
I was probably standing right here arguing with you about dripping on the floor. What, did I get a parking ticket in Iowa or something?
Don't you wish you could fix that? Does the name Martha ring a bell with you?
Again with the ringing of bells? What are you talking about, Felix?
Oscar!
Who is she?
On November 13th, Felix Unger was asked to remove himself from his place of residence. That request came from his wife. Deep down, he knew she was right, but he also knew that someday he would return to her. With nowhere else to go, he appeared at the home of his friend, Oscar Madison. Several years earlier, Madison's wife had thrown him out, requesting that he never return. Can two divorced men share an apartment without driving each other crazy?
Mr. Jack Klugman, ladies and gentlemen. Jack, at this time, we'd like to present to you two of your friends, two wonderful people. The first guy wants to make a deal, and the other one is a beautiful, lovely, gorgeous actress and performer. Please welcome to the stage Mr. Monty Hall and Connie Stevens. Former honoree.
Hi, everybody. I'll get on this side. Besides this great body of work, I didn't have the pleasure of really working with Jack. We were on a stage a couple of times, but I have to tell you that I don't think I've ever met anybody that I loved as much, loved to be in his company, and I'm so glad that we are friends. I really am, and I'm honored to be here for you, Jack. Thank you.
You know, in my lengthy career, I did over 7,000 television shows, but the two that I enjoyed the most is when I appeared as a guest star on The Odd Couple, working with Tony Randall and Jack Klugman. What a delight that was. But at one time, when I was under contract to ABC, I did a bunch of late night shows. And one of the shows I did was a story on gambling called Gamblers Anonymous, you may recall. And now, when I was going to do the show Gamblers Anonymous, I decided I would call two of my friends who I knew had been addicted by that particular disease. So I called Jack Klugman and Walter Matthau. And Walter Matthau said, I'll be there. And then I called Jack, and Jack said, wait a minute. I don't gamble anymore, I don't want to be associated with gambling anymore, and I'll bet you $50 Matthau doesn't show up. Now, Jack, I'm going to induct you as an honorary New Yorker, and what I need now is, where's that wonderful wand that I'm going to cast over his body? I have to hit him with a wand. I think it's a stick ball. You know, we don't have a wand, so we have one of those stick ball sticks, you know. May I have it, please? Thank you. Thank you, Sal. Thank you very much.
Here's your wand.
Yeah. Now, would you hold this for me?
I would love to, but why are we all back here?
Well, I don't know because they...
Come on. Move up here so everybody can see you. This is crazy. Yep. Ready? Boy.
Where you're running.
Okay, right here. Okay. We got the star up here. Great.
Now, Jack Klugman, you shall repeat after me the oath that I'm going to administer to you. I'm Marty Hall, and I approve of this message. Jack, you will repeat after me. I hereby, well, you don't have to read the whole thing, just nod your head. Hereby acknowledge and recognize the outstanding history and vitality of the people of New York.
Do you acknowledge that?
Yes.
Beautifully read. I recall many wonderful memories of having lived and having worked in New York.
Yes.
Don't pad your part, you know. I promise to wear proudly the mantle as a son of the great city of New York.
Yes.
And now, with the power invested in me by Mayor Bloomberg, who wants a third term, I will take the stick and we will adopt you. Jack Klugman is a loving son of the city of New York, and I do it by doing this, and watch your head. You are now a loving son of the city of New York. Congratulations and mazel tov.
First, I want to thank Connie and Marty, for coming and doing this wonderful thing. And I never expected this, but I love two things, I'm sure of. I love New York, and I love Jerry Stiller. So those are the two things that make me be here. Now, I came to New York in 66, and in 67, I did a play with Jerry Stiller. We did a show, we rehearsed for about a month, but we only did one performance. He was Paul Muni. He was so good, so heavy, so direct. I thought, wow, this guy is really terrific. Then a couple of years later, I heard that he and Annie were doing a comedy act. I said, well, it's gotta be the wrong Jerry Stiller, it can't be this guy. Well, they were funny. And it was Jerry Stiller, and it shows you, if you're gonna be an actor, you gotta learn to cut the lamb, you gotta learn to cut beef, you gotta learn to cut everything. And he's just very versatile. And that's why I'm here. And when I first came, I lived at 113th Street. I lived with Charlie Bronson. We had one room, $7 a week. And Charlie came in and first of all, he became my trainer. And he was one, I taught him how to read, he taught me how to get my physical gym. And he got me my first job. He got me my first job in Mr. Roberts on the road with Henry Fonda. My first job was with Henry Fonda. And I played the second lead, I understood it, the doc. And I got to play it with him for 6 weeks. The best actor I've ever known. Not the one of the best, but the best actor I've ever known. And so, how could I not love New York? It's been the first for me for everything. I came there in 1966, and I left in 1973. No, 46. 46 I came there. 46. Yeah, no, and 46, and I left in 73. And I love New York. That's it.
Thank you all. Jack, we have one little surprise for you right now. At this time, it's going to give me great pleasure to bring someone to you from the dean. She's the dean of the College of Fine Arts at Carnegie Mellon University. Please welcome Dr. Hillary Robinson.
Good evening. As was said, my name is Hillary Robinson, and it is my honor to serve as the Dean of the College of Fine Arts at Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh. Carnegie Mellon was founded in 1900 as Carnegie Institute of Technology, Carnegie Tech, by Andrew Carnegie, and we're very proud of our Scottish heritage. and celebrate it in any number of ways, and I'll get back to that later. In 1911, the School of Drama was founded and is in fact the oldest school of drama in the country. Many distinguished alumni have emerged from the School of Drama, and I'm sure you'll recognize many of their names and be able to add to this list. People like Bud Yorkin, Gary Smith, Holly Hunter, Ted Danson, John Wells, Stephen Bochco, and Jack Klugman. Jack enrolled in the School of Drama in 1939, and while in school, he appeared in As You Like It, The Time of Your Life, and The Merchant of Yonkers. Sadly for us, but wonderfully for him, he was called into service in the professions before he completed his degree. So today, it is my great pleasure to recognize and celebrate Jack's many accomplishments as an actor of the stage and screen, as well as an author, by bestowing upon him an honorary doctoral degree from Carnegie Mellon. He has to put a robe on for this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the robe ceremony. Here we go. You hold this, I'll hold the robe.
Okay, here we go. Like that. There you go. You want to put your arm in here and hold that. This is a very big thing for the man who grabs it. It doesn't have to zip, it will wait.
This is all a surprise.
This is your graduation ceremony.
Yeah. So, the citation. Oh, has he got his hat on? Yes. Oh, wonderful.
Never hat on?
Yes. Carnegie Mellon alumnus Jack Klugman is a comedic icon and distinguished dramatic actor. During a long and varied career in television, film, and theatre, he has created a truly significant body of work. Early in his career, Mr. Klugman was chosen to work with such established giants of the entertainment industry as Ethel Merman, Henry Fonda, and Judy Garland. Throughout his career, Mr. Klugman achieved many professional awards, including a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, 3 Emmy Awards, and a Golden Globe. He is acclaimed for his work in Broadway's Gypsy and in the films Goodbye Columbus and 12 Angry Men, among others. On television, he is beloved for his Oscar Madison role opposite Tony Randall in The Odd Couple and for breaking new ground in Quincy. The Carnegie Mellon community is very proud of Mr. Klugman and today celebrates his distinguished achievements by awarding him an honorary Doctor of Fine Arts degree. This is the magic bit, where the hood goes on. By virtue of the authority granted by the Board of Trustees, I hereby bestow this honorary degree upon Jack Klugman, with all the rights, honors, privileges, and responsibilities pertaining thereto.
One more gift here. Here's your cane. And here is your honorary kilt that you'll be wearing on the parade. Mr. Jack Klugman, ladies and gentlemen. God bless you. Thank you. Oh, wait, she's got something. Hold it. Hold it. We have something else to give you. Oh, I'd like to see that. You want to hold my kilt?
Dr. Klugman. Dr. Klugman, I don't know if you know, but a young student at the same time as you was Andy Warhol. And we would love to have given you a portrait by Andy Warhol. We'd have loved to have given you an original Andy Warhol. Sadly, we cannot, but we've done the second best thing.
Andy's here.
I don't know if you can see that on the picture. It's an Andy Warhol portrait, of Dr. Klugman.
I never, ever, ever expected this. And I want to thank everybody that came, and everybody that's here on stage. I just want to thank everybody. That's all.
Dr. Jack Klugman. Thank you all. Thank you. Doctor, thank you very much. Thank you. The stagehand is leaving now.